BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hi, and welcome to the New Arts Connection. This is James Carroll's program. I guess it's called New Arts Alive, and I'm your host, Ron Schira. No, I'm not. My name is Peter John Snyder. I'm a Berks County-based visual artist, and tonight I am interviewing the actual narrator for New Arts program, New Arts Alive, and that would be Ron. He's sitting next to me. How are you doing, Ron?
Hi, Peter. Hi.
Good. I guess a lot of you don't really know Ron's background and what he's done for the arts here in Berks County. Quite frankly, he's a native of Berks County. Mm-hmm. He's been living here for like 60 years.
64.
He's a visual artist. He's also an art critic for the Reading Eagle. He's a short story writer, a video artist, and a music and sound creator. He writes short stories and poems. And tonight it's my pleasure that we interview the host of New Arts Alive, Ron Schira.
Thank you. Tell
us a little bit about yourself and your background.
Well, I grew up just loving art. It just was that when I was a kid, I had a hip disease called leg Perthes. And what happened with that was I spent a lot of time nursing that problem, because when I was 8 years old, it created a decalcification problem around your hip bone. And I couldn't walk very long for very far. I had, you know, a problem with it. I was in the Boy Scouts flying a kite, and then all of a sudden I fell down because I had a lot of pain. So they looked at it and they said, oh, well, you know, this is a problem that one out of 300 kids get, and it's hereditary. So I ended up doing a lot of getting into hobbies. And my biggest hobby was drawing, painting, writing poetry, that sort of stuff. Because I couldn't participate in the sports like all of my other friends were doing. So I thought, you know, this is the best thing for me. So I just started copying images out of comic books, the Walter Foster booklets of how to draw a horse, and, you know, drawing the human hand and all that. And I did. And I read and practiced all of that stuff for a long time. Now, the thing with leg Perthes is that you have to grow out of it, because 8 years old, your body is still developing and your bones are still growing. So when you hit 12, 13, and you start reaching that puberty age, it just stops decalcifying and hardens up again, and then your joints are normal. Well, that's what I had. So I took two classes of art every day at Governor Mifflin, and I graduated. I went to the Philadelphia College of Art for a short period of time and left because I ran out of money. And then I just started working, and, you know, working at everything. You know, mostly like, I mean, I'd done everything from being a new, from a paper carrier, newspaper carrier, to a stock boy, to a sales clerk, to a customer service representative at the Home Depot, to a mail deliverer at, you know, at Penske Truck Leasing, and a warranty claims writer, and I did all of that stuff. And I got married, and had a child. Well, my wife had a child, and then got divorced. So in the interim, I needed to make some money so that I could pay my lawyer. So my good friend Marilyn Fox had suggested to me that I go over to George Hatza on her suggestion and ask to be a writer, which I did. And George was very open to it. He had he gave me two assignments and said, "I want you to write an article about two assignments, and then he'll tell me whether or not I'm accepted as a writer for the newspaper." Well, I did that, and he rejected both articles, but he hired me. So, and I've been doing it now for almost 25 years.
And you've had what, 1,300 articles?
Yeah, 1,260-something. But
Who's counting?
Yeah, but who's counting? Who's counting?
And that's for the Reading Eagle.
Yes.
Art criticism.
Art criticism.
So basically, you go to art shows, and you look at them, you take pictures, you take all this in, and then you, like, write about it. It's either positive, negative, it's could be just an overview, it could be anything.
Right. Sometimes I never want to write a fluff article, because I just think that that's plain hypocritical. That you don't praise somebody for just doing the average stuff. I mean, there are some people that are very good at it, and they think that they're the best thing since powdered milk. But when you really look at it and you say, okay, well, he or she is not doing this, and they're not doing that, and I see references to all kinds of other artists that are sitting in with this, and what I try to do is make sense out of what they do. Most of the time, see, if there's a really terrible show going on, I won't cover it. I mean, I just won't do it. I will only write about things that I feel have some sort of merit.
Well, most people who are exhibiting don't really understand. If you ask for a critical review from a critical professional critic, art critic, you got to take it. You know, some people expect they're going to be, you know, loving it and everything else, but they're putting it out in the public. They're being putting in the professional realm. They have price tags on it, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you need to do that, and you do that quite well.
Thank you. It is difficult sometimes, because there are many times that these people are your friends.
I know. It's tough. Uh-huh.
So you have to tell them the truth about what they're doing. And sometimes, I mean, I expect it. I want the truth. You know, if I'm doing schlock work, I want to know about it. You know,
right.
I just because I'm not going to put something out that's just ugly or stupid or derivative. I won't do it.
Good for you. Mm. Proud of you. He's a great critic, by the way. So if any of you get the newspaper or get it online, you can check out his articles, like Sundays and Thursdays, or
every Sunday and occasional Thursday. But it just depends on how many things are happening in the county. And it is surprising that the amount of art that's happening right now is still progressing, but the landscape is changing. Like I see different things coming out of the Goggle Works and new shows over at the Friedman Gallery. And Friedman just got a new curator, Elena Coates, very, very sharp, intelligent woman.
Well, let's face it, art in Berks County is tough.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's tough for artists. If you know, it's the what we've known for years is you either need to leave the area to be famous, or you need to die, or something like that.
Right.
But some of us, I've kept it going, and this is where we live. This is what we want to do. We want to support it. We want to push the boundaries of where we're at, and that's what we want to do. And, you know, when we see your art, we're going to see some stuff that you've been pushing.
Well, in return, I feel that you're doing the same thing.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
But this is about you, not me.
Yeah, I know, but I'm good. You know, but I just want to say that I appreciate what you do just as much.
Ron and I are best friends. Actually, we've been friends since 1981. We had our first exhibition together at the Wyomissing Institute of the Arts in 81. Then we had a return one, I think, in 83.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did we have a third one? I think in 87 or something like that?
In 87 we had another one.
So that's where we got together and we've been friends ever since. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to grill him on stuff. So.
Well, he always tells me the truth. He tells me the truth.
That's right.
Which
the truth
is what
will set
I
you
want.
Free, man.
Yeah, the truth will set you free. And it's set me free a couple times.
Okay, you also have done over 80 programs here for James Carroll. James Carroll was the brains and genius behind the New Arts Program in Kutztown, so our hats off to him.
Yep.
He has sort of given the mantle to Ron, and for now, he's going to do a lot more programs, but he's already done 80 of them. Mm-hmm. I'm just sort of sitting in. This is where Ron usually is on a Wednesday night? Every Wednesday?
Twice a month.
Twice a month.
It's at the first and the fourth week of each month.
All right. So you can see him twice a fourth week of the month, so with Ron on NAP Connection or the New Arts Alive. I'm not sure what the difference is, but...
Yeah. Well, I think that's probably in the changing of things.
Okay, so let's sort of start delving into your artwork. Because that's what we're here about. We know, I mean, we're not going to read any art criticism. That's what you get paid for. That's kind of your thing. You're really mm-hmm. awesome at mm-hmm. it. You do writing. But tonight, a lot of this is going to be about the visual arts because we have things we can look at. We have pictures of your studio. We might have a video. I'm not sure if you brought one or not.
Yeah, it's in here somewhere. I'll have to dig it up.
So why don't we start with... where you work. And don't be afraid when you see this.
Yeah,
don't
this
be scared.
Is scary stuff. Yep.
There it is.
That's my that's my studio. That's where I work.
Most artists are slobs.
And I'll tell you what, I am king of the slobs. That place is a mess. But I know where everything is. If somebody says to me, oh, find me a kneaded eraser. Do you have a kneaded eraser? I know exactly where it is, you know? That sort of thing. And, you know, sometimes I have to, like, push things apart in order to get to it, but there it is.
How do you move around in there?
Very carefully.
And that's in your house, right?
This is in my house.
Okay.
This is a bedroom that my parents... I inherited the house from my mom and dad, who passed away a couple of years ago. And this bedroom that it was the same room that my father passed away in. He had a coronary thrombosis in his bed, and it did him in. But I figured that if I'm going to be painting and I'm going to be working, yeah, that's probably a good place to be. So I used my dad's energy to work on this stuff.
Cool.
And some people would want to avoid that, but I remember my dad saying to me, when I die, don't dig a hole in the ground and die with me. It's, you know, I want you to go on. I want you to be happy. I want you to have a good life. So just do the right thing and be who you are. And I'm like, okay, that's good. So I'm taking that to heart, and I use that in everything I do. So... and sometimes I think of my father as being still there, but it's a pretty big universe. What can I say?
Cool.
So.
All right. What do you got for us?
Well, next is, all right, well, this is a later series. These are called the assembled paintings, and all the colors in that are all pieces from... come on, get back. This computer worked perfectly. Okay, let's see. Da, 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 da. Come on. All right.
Artists are not known for being technical wizards.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, there we go. See, now this...
Is that the same one?
No, it's a different one.
Boy, the colors are rich, and it just feels like the texture of it's just jumping out at you.
Well, they're all separate pieces. This is more of a collage than it actually is painting.
Okay.
Because what I did was I collected pieces from the palettes. I used to work on paper palettes,
mm-hmm.
you know, and the wood palettes and stuff like the traditional kind.
Yeah.
But at one point, I accidentally procured a McDonald's tray, which was plastic, and I thought, well, I'm going to use this for my palette because I think I can clean it. Well, when the paint's dried, I could peel the paint directly off of it, and I thought, well, you know what? I could just destroy the environment a little bit more by throwing these things in the trash, you know, because it's plastic. Essentially, acrylic paint is plastic.
Mm-hmm.
So what I started doing was with other acrylic paint, with acrylic medium, I started gluing them onto canvases and boards and such. And I had so much of this junk that it actually made a series. And I have one of them, a real one, right here. So.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So if you can zoom in on that, that's, well, yeah. So let's see.
Let me see that thing.
Yeah.
How about it? It is collage. I actually thought it was all globs of paint.
No, it's all tiny pieces of paint that I peeled off of the canvas, off the.
Is this how big the other ones are? About the same size?
Some are bigger. Some are bigger. I did a couple of them that were 16 by 20 inches.
Okay.
Yeah, and those are at home.
And by the way, the viewing audience, you can always call us here at 610-378-0426. Ask Ron some questions.
Talk to him.
Grill him a little bit. You know, make it fun. We love calls coming in. Thank you.
Yeah. Yell at me. Criticize me.
Criticize the critic.
Honestly. Give it to me. I want it.
All right. What else do you have?
So, okay, that's another one. And then we'll go back a little bit more. Now these are works on paper, and the watercolor and watercolor pencil. And what I've been doing is I've been working with sprays, like you know, those little spritz canisters. And I will paint, and then what I'll do is I'll spray it with water. And then after I spray it with water, I'll dab it with sponges or other, you know, other absorbent things, rags, towels, that sort of stuff, and take the water off of it, and then let it, the color and the texture just do what it does. And watercolor, I feel, is much more natural to work with than acrylic, so I've been doing a lot of watercolors lately. I think that they're and really unexplored territory.
Okay, now, the last grouping and this one, and I'm not sure what's coming up next.
That's more of the same.
A question about it before you go any further.
Sure.
For the viewing audience here, there's a lot of people who don't really understand what you're doing. Why are you doing this in this manner? Why are you showing us sprays and spritzes of color and color running down and globs of paint? Why are you doing that? Explain it to us.
Well, what it is to me is just another manner of painting. I want to create a new paradigm of how you look at art and how you produce art and how you think about art, because I think that we have so much stuff that we just keep doing the same thing over and over, and it's like the saying that if you keep doing the same thing over and over and expect something different to come out, that's a definition of madness.
Insanity,
right. So
doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result.
Exactly. That's not scientific method to me at all. So I figure that you have to allow chance into the work, so that if you're doing something and you allow it to be what it is, say like this one here, these are just colors. I took the same spray bottles and I put a little bit of pigment in them, and then I shook them up and I sprayed them onto these lines. When I removed the water from it, I got this effect, and to me it's kind of dazzling. I like to look at it and see it as energy, as space. I need to think more about what the world is composed of and what matter and what time and all of that stuff is. And I think that that's pretty much in how do you say, in conjunction with our scientific community, you know, like particle theory and what do they call those, bosons. No, I don't want to do that. Do I want to change the colors?
Oh boy.
Clothes. Yeah.
Well, okay, so go to another one, and I'm going to ask another question, so we don't dwell on it. Okay, how about my granddaughter can do that. How many times have you heard that?
More times than I care to say.
Okay, explain it to us. Why is it different than your granddaughter?
It's not different. I don't think it's different at all. I think that your granddaughter, when she creates art, is just as important as anything that any other artist creates. I mean, it is just, it's the act of creation. It's more than that. It's just how this, how this comes out of you. I mean, you know, they stick figures, whatever, you know, just scribbles. All of that stuff is important.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, you know, when I see a child really involved with something, keep my hands out of it, you know? When my daughter was doing stuff like that, she'd ask me, "What do you think, Daddy?" You know, and I'd be like, "Oh, honey, it's gorgeous, it's beautiful." And it is, you know, and I really mean it that it is.
You know what I see when I look at that? I see Ron Schira's version of Picasso's Guernica. For some reason, I don't know what it is about it, but it reminds me of what happened with his massive painting. Mm-hmm. See, now that would be my interpretation when I see it, and everybody out there is seeing something different. And so that's the beauty of abstraction and non-objectivity in art, that you can see something different, and everybody has their own opinion, just like you have your own opinion as an art critic.
You know, well, I try to see what other people are thinking, is what it is. And really, whatever comes out of them, if they're doing it honestly and truthfully, then I appreciate it. You know, I don't care what it is. And sometimes somebody works in realism. Now, there's a couple really excellent realists that are working in this area.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I'm not, you know, I don't criticize them just because they're not abstract.
No, of course not.
No. I mean, you think of some of the effort that goes into this stuff. It's unbelievable. Like Michelle Burns' latest work, and who else? There's a number of them.
As long as they're creative and they're pushing forward, that's the key.
Yeah,
pushing forward,
right? So, and that's what I appreciate.
That's a great drawing, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Don't forget to call us 610-378-0426 and talk to Ron, grill him a little bit.
Yeah, hurt me. Come on. You know?
What do we got there?
Okay, now this is a different series. Now this here are works on canvas board. And what I've been doing is I've been making drawings with pens, like with regular ballpoint pens, Bic pens, gel pens, and I've just been drawing on the canvases, and I'm very carefully and selectively choosing the colors to go into it. So it creates like this
stained glass,
but it also creates this sort of chaos ripple. I like the idea of, and I have a whole series of paintings called chaotic paintings, which is a combination of the word chaos and order. And it's a real word, look it up. It's called chaotic, it's chaordic. And I think that the universe is not separated into chaos and order. Chaos and order is combined. It's the same thing. There is an order to the chaos. There is chaos to the order. And in that way, things can change. Because you don't... if everything is ordered, then it becomes static and unchangeable. And I don't believe in that. I think it needs to... I think that in order for it to progress, it has to have a little bit of chaos.
Okay.
Yeah. And this is kind of the same thing, but this is more a little bit more influenced by supremacist logic. And
is there a top or bottom to these things, or can they be swung around? I mean, that's the beauty of art. You can look at it any way.
You can put it any way you like. I mean, I that's hung on a nail, there's no cord behind it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, because the frame is very thin. So there's this little tiny nail that goes underneath the level of the wood and just hangs there like that. I just take it level and there it is. But I mean, you could just as easily take it and turn it to the side and put it any way you want because it looks better to you that way. Or maybe you could take it and put it that way and then a month later you're tired of it so you switch it around. And that's the possibility of it too because I don't have any control over how somebody looks at it.
Now how big is this?
This one's 9 by 12 inches.
Oh, so they're small.
This is small, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, these are pretty easy to deal with.
Wow.
And there's another one.
That's pretty cool.
So.
Now, is that paint or ink or what are we looking at here?
This is acrylic and pen, and ballpoint pen. Because I made the drawing first, but what happened is in the process of painting, I kind of obliterated the lines. Because I just use a straight edge. It doesn't. It could be a piece of cardboard, and a ruler. You know, so you know anything that has a straight edge on it, piece of paper, birthday card, and I'll create these lines with it. The circles are freehand. Doing the best I can to get as round a circle as I can. And then I go over the whole thing with acrylic.
Is it a self-portrait?
A self-portrait. They're probably all self-portraits.
See that?
Yeah.
Looks like you.
It looks like me. Oh, yeah. The chin, you know? my Jay Leno chin, yeah.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah, it does. But, I like it.
Yeah.
And this one here is more about
gears,
gears, pulleys.
Pulleys?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Connections?
Connections.
Like NAP connections?
NAP connections. The strength of, well, it's all about the tension of these objects inside of it. Because at any given moment, if you don't have them connected with those lines, those pen lines, by the way, they could easily just float right off the canvas.
It's interesting. On your computer, it looks yellow. Up on that screen, it looks orange. It's pretty nice.
Yeah, I like it. Yeah, that's pretty cool.
So, and again, that's small, 9 by 12?
These are all 9 by 12.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah. And that's another one.
This is kind of a series.
Yes, this is a series.
Okay.
This is a series. I made about 25 of these. Okay, back to drawings. Now this is just a freehand drawing. I didn't use any straight edges with this. I just kind of like went crazy with the scribbling.
Much more organic.
Much more organic.
Much more whimsical.
Whimsical, yes.
Circus-like.
Yeah, yeah.
It almost reminds me of a party, having fun. I mean, it's a happy painting. The other ones, some of them were a little bit heavier.
Mm-hmm.
Or drawing. I don't know. You use paint, right? Is that watercolors?
That's watercolor.
Okay.
Yeah, that's watercolor.
Now, did the watercolor go after the ink lines, or did the ink lines come first?
The ink lines came first, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Because, I mean, if you look at that circle up top with the little blue blue wedge there and the yellow next to it, I had to be very careful in that. So, I mean, there is a certain, I think there's a lot of whimsy in this, but at the same time, there's a lot of control, which is the chaotic nature of it. Now, this is totally control.
Yes.
Yeah. Because I really worked on this one. Now this is a little larger. This is 11 by 14 or 14 by 11 standing.
And what's the checkerboard? Is that like chalk? What is that?
No, that's all acrylic.
Okay.
It's all acrylic, and the squares are kind of like a grayish white. Well, the white is I went over the whole thing with a gray, and then I drew the lines, and the checkerboards. And then I filled it in with the grayish white paint and the gold.
Okay.
And the square up on top, or the overlapping lines, is just...
Was that on top of it?
It's on top of it,
yeah. You decided at some point you wanted to just put that on top, or... So it was kind of an organic process. One thing led to the next.
That's exactly right.
Okay.
Because I didn't really plan... I don't really plan the paintings.
Right.
They kind of happen, like you say, they happen organically, and then they just kind of become what they,
what they are.
And this is the same thing, more or less.
Looks like he could have been born in Russia in the 30s or 40s with some of these, you know?
Well, that's a big influence on me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I really like the suprematist and the work by Mondrian and who's the other guy? Elazitsky, people of that nature, because in a lot of my artistic travels, like to museums and whatnot, I've seen the originals of those, and it's like when you get in front of a real Elazitsky painting, and you get to look at it, there is just such a feeling of correctness about it, you know, and I can stand and look at one of those things for a long time. So I figured that, you know, well, I'm going to do the same thing. Now, you know, and I'm not afraid to copy an idea, but I want to see where it leads me,
right,
where it takes me in that idea.
Maybe the Russians were hacking your brain.
Yeah, they were doing that before the Clinton thing, you know. You know. So, now, this is the same thing, but this is a watercolor.
Okay.
And pen. So that's pretty much the same thing. And this was a drawing that I didn't like it, so I decided that I would get something to kind of screw it up. And I almost said another word there. But anyway, this, you know, that whole, you know, I'm pointing at it, people can't see it. But the whole thing is, you know, surrounded around. Okay, well, the process on this one is that I take an ink dropper. Instead of using a ballpoint pen, I thought I would have more fluidity and more of a natural line if I would take a dropper, an ink dropper.
Mm.
So I'd get, you know, a bottle of black ink with the squeeze dropper, and I'd just do whatever would come out of my gesture, you know, from it. And then I would crisscross it and scribble over it and stuff. And then when the ink dried, I'd fill it in.
Okay.
So it would be the same process as the drawings. See, like what you have on that side, that's exactly what it was.
Oh. So. Can you check this out? There we go.
Yeah. So the lines on this are all done by an ink dropper. And then when that dried, I filled it in with watercolor.
Okay.
Now these are works on paper. I created quite a few of these. In fact, I spent almost all of 2014 and 2015, and made maybe about 200 of them.
Yeah, they're beautiful.
Yeah.
And we still didn't get a phone call. 610-378-0426.
Hello.
Hello.
So, but anyway, if you want, there's more of it over here. Now, this one here is a much bigger version of that. And
what is that, like 18 by 24 or something?
No, it's 20. It's 20 by 30, I think it is. It's a regular sheet of watercolor paper. You know, arches.
So the black lines are first. Filling in afterwards.
Absolutely.
Okay. Do you put any more black lines in after you're done filling them in?
Never.
Okay. That's a little rule. A lot of artists work by their own set of rules. I have my own set. I'm sure you have your own set.
Mm-hmm. Well, I figure if it's not right to begin with, it's not right at all.
Oh, cool. Zoom in.
Yeah. Oh, that's, yeah, thank you. That's nice. I like how that looks. So... And that is...
See that? Even the camera people can be artsy.
You look at that. Thank you. Thank you, Joan.
All right. What else you got there, young man?
Oh, my. All right. Well, down here on the bottom, if you can come in on this one, that's another example of that. That's another chaotic. but that one actually has a separate title. That one is called Laughing Dragon. So I don't know why Laughing Dragon came to mind.
Try this. Wow. Boy, that comes out nice on the TV. It's really colorful.
Yeah, it's really great.
And it's even colorful now that I'm looking at it in real life. So ink lines first,
absolutely.
Color second.
Yep.
Awesome.
Yep. It's a drawing first before anything.
And it's watercolor.
And it is watercolor, yes.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
I managed to, when I sold the painting to a friend of mine.
And, what, to give it back to you? That's why it's here?
No.
I didn't want it, did I?
Yeah, I didn't want it. I like the painting, you know?
It doesn't matter. Just bust my butt.
I know. That's good. It's cool. People have done that.
Keep moving. We got lots to see, right?
Oh, yes, we do.
Okay. All right, keep moving.
Let's go. Now, this one here is pretty much the same as the order of it.
A whole different configuration.
Well, yeah, because it was a sponge.
Uh-huh.
I dipped a sponge in some black ink, and I just went down, you know, like a staggered line down the one side, then a staggered like another side, and you know, and then lightened it and subtracted some of the paint from it, and that's what I got. And the lines came first, the crisscross came first, and then the colors came in next.
Okay.
So it's just...
Nice. Black and white?
Black and white, yeah. And...
same idea, just mm-hmm. using different values and tones of black ink.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And it is ink, by the way. This whole thing is ink.
Okay.
Okay. And this one, I sold this
Almost reminds me of a little bit of op art, you know, kind of like this. So you'll stare at it long enough and you'll probably see like... you know, an alligator or something.
Yeah. I know what you're saying. I got one of those magic realism, you know. You stare at it and they have to cross your eyes in order to see it. Yeah. And there's another one that's a little smaller.
Okay.
I sold that one. That made me happy. And by the way, if you want any of these works, you can contact the Reading Eagle at life@readingeagle.com, and you know, just they'll refer you to me, because you know I don't normally give out my emails.
It's a shameless plug for money.
Yeah, give me money. Yeah. Now this one here is a little bit heavier because the lines came out like really hard and heavy on this one, and I thought, well, I'm going to go with it. And so I just went with it, and I played with that black line until I got this big, massive crap, and then I filled it in.
Well, if you wouldn't experiment with different stuff, you wouldn't be moving forward in your life, so it makes sense is what you're doing.
Correct. Sometimes, what was it? I have to quote Bob Ross. There are no mistakes. There are no mistakes. There was only happy accidents.
There you go.
Yeah.
Wow. Well,
this is the same thing.
Hmm.
Yeah. So,
nice.
Now these are all ink and watercolor. And these are all 9x12s.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Nice color sense. Nice whimsy.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Nice movement.
Well, I think that you know that you have to trust your arm, and that's
right.
Yeah. And sometimes sometimes I start. I have absolutely no idea what I'm going to do, and I just take the ink and I just start splashing it around.
Well, I'm sure with art criticism, you start with not knowing what exactly you're going to do, and then you just pull it together.
When I go to see a show, and I get people that want me to read their statements and all of this other stuff, when I before I go there, I'll deliberately not do it. Because it just, I want, when I go into a show, and if I'm not aware of the artist or who it is or what they're doing, I want a first impression.
Right.
You know, I want to walk in and I want to breathe it and I want to say, oh, okay, I get it, you know, or I don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And if I don't get it, then I'm asking questions.
Good.
Yeah. So this shot here is an installation view at Studio B in their back gallery. And they put up 40 of these, and there was another wall that has another amount of them, but this one here took a better picture. So anyhow, these are all like done on paper, hemp paper, like recycled hemp paper. And what I did was I took a scraper with gouache paint, and I would like create lines, different opposing moves, that sort of thing. That's not it. But and then what I would do is get some colored pencils and go inside of it and start drawing on top of the black gouache. And it'll always be the same black gouache because I had to use the Utrecht, you know, jet black. And that's what it gave me. And that when it dried, it had this nice chalky texture to it,
mm-hmm.
That really was conducive to colored pencil.
They almost look like little maquettes for sculptures. You know, you could take them and blow them up and be big, massive. I mean, they're very simple yet strong. You know, very strong statements, almost mm-hmm. Asian in a sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like them. The only reason I stopped doing them was because I couldn't get the tablets with the hemp paper anymore. Now these are drawings that this is also on the hemp paper, but the light on this one has made it a little bit more. It's given it more of a gray tone than a yellow tone.
Mm-hmm.
So and these are just plain drawings. Like what I there are other things that I do that are just pen drawings, and that's it. And I've done like hundreds of them. It's like, I don't know. I'm just a very bored guy. Oh, here's one of those.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. That.
Talk about it.
Yeah. This one here is the one that's on gouache, and those are pencil. That's colored pencil, and what I've done is taken a straight edge. And just made my choices. What I would do is I would select a group of pencils that I thought were in a good color. So I went and made the gouache, you know, in straight lines, just as much as it could fill that area. And I crisscrossed them and covered them and stuff. So I created like this leveling where there's a top and a bottom to it. And they're all on this handmade paper that I get from White Crow Press and Doug Zuko and his paper.
Here's another one.
Process. And this one that Peter's holding now, this is a this one is made on that paper, right?
It's really cool.
Yeah.
The texture's incredible. I mean, when I touch it and look at it and feel it, it's really neat.
Yeah. Show them the back of it. And what the back of this looks like. This is like
handmade paper, very stiff.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Nice.
Thank you.
Okay, it's 6:45 and nobody called. 610-378-0426. This is your last chance. All right, what else do you got there, Ron?
All right. Oh, this is another pen drawing that I did on the hemp paper. And I guess the same thing. And then in the beginning, what I started doing was I was thinking about drawing real things, like not to escape from my realistic base. There was a lot of work that I did in the beginning when I went to school and when I studied at the the Yoakum Institute of the Arts years ago with Ralph Beinert and Marion Goodman, and they gave me quite a few pointers on how to paint. I was only like 8-10 years old at the time. So I studied the realistic end of it, and I did a whole bunch of realistic paintings and stuff. But this one here, I just liked the way that this bug looked on a photograph that I saw. And
you mean it's not a horse? I see anything I want to see. Remember?
That's right. So yeah, well, this was, it happened really. Really quickly, because I really didn't plan this one, but it was a spontaneous drawing. There's no pencil underneath this, no erasures, no, you know, yeah, none of that. So, and there's another one, you know, of a group of flowers, like a bouquet, and I just did that one. I mean, if you were to take a good look at this one, you would just see that it's just mismatch of lines, and you know, which I like. Okay, now we're going back to the paintings. Now this is a larger painting. This is like 24 by 48 inches, or 20, I think, maybe even 54 inches. I mean, it's pretty big. But I had I just created this one just as more of like an experiment. Like the other ones, and I just wanted to see what this kind of color combination would do, and I wanted to, you know, put different objects in it, like triangular, square, you know, and sharp colors, and it just came together like that.
Okay.
Yeah. And here, we're going into the 90s now, and what I did at that time, I guess about 94. I used to do a whole bunch of poetic drawings. Now, if you can't read this, the things in this say, glow, little glow worm, glimmer, glimmer, escapes of pressurized light. What is really inside the horn of plenty? Where does the light escape to? Burst like a God balloon. Remain in your continuum and radiate. So
it's an art poem painting.
It's an art poem painting, yeah. You know, because it really doesn't have any. It really doesn't make any true sense to it, but they were just things that, you know, I wanted. I heard the song "Glow, Little Glow," where, you know, but, and that's what inspired it. So it was actually a part of that. Now here, this is about, when I was 2 years old, I had swallowed some dry phlegm in my throat. And my father took me to the hospital, but then, like, I discovered later on that I had asthma, so I couldn't breathe very well. But I was remembering, and I was feeling this thing in my throat, and I said, "I can hear you, but air escapes my lungs through the hole in my throat, and I cannot say anything." So there's a little bit of there's sadness and loss in this thing, and it also again kind of says about my history as having a bunch of health issues. Now this is one of those. This is what the drawing tablet looked like when I was making it.
Okay.
Same with that.
Yep.
Oh, and this is a painting that was that I had. At Clayon, Maine, they had a display of my work there, and there were something like 60 pieces in it. And this one is just called Snake Charmer, and it's 4 by 5 feet.
Nice.
And then I also, at about the same time, made a bunch of drawings on graph paper, or, you know, like this. Well, this is actually a ledger, and I used the gouache. And the colored pencils, and in some cases I was using wax crayons, but I created a whole series of these, and I only stopped because I ran out of these ledgers, and the ledgers also came from my father, because my father had two tablets that he's sitting in his den when he passed away. And I just took them and used them.
Do you have any of those round paintings in here?
Not in here, but I have...
Because we want to show that before we run out of time.
Yeah, we're getting close. Yeah.
Can you check this one down here, Joan? There it is.
There it is, yeah.
So, yeah. Why the round format?
Well, because my buddy Doug Zuko said, hey, I have some round paper. Would you?
Okay,
you know?
So the paper informed
Informed the work.
Okay.
So, I mean, there's a sort of a cosmos idea there, you know? The expanding universe theme.
Right.
What I did was I started in the center and I just... played around with it until it came out, and until that came out, and I did about 10 of those.
Okay.
And I have another one over here I can show you.
Go ahead.
Without pulling my cord here. There we go. So, anyway.
Here, I'll hold it. You talk it.
Okay. That's pretty much the same deal. It's ink, and this one has different materials.
Hey, look, we can make it into a moving one. It's like a kaleidoscope.
Yeah.
Isn't that funny? Hey, it's your new thing.
Well, it's kind of like follows my same idea of the expanding universe,
right.
Chaos and order, cool. And it just follows this trend.
Oh, check that out. Yeah. We're making new headway in TV news.
Yeah. Cool. Wonderful.
Very nice. Anything else before we wrap this thing up? That's unusual.
That's unusual. Oh yeah. Where's the? Let me. I have to get into the different function here. In order to do that, but I one of my video. Okay, here we go.
Okay, thank you.
Come on,
Ron has made over 200 videos. They're on his YouTube channel. And you can see them there, Ron Schira. S-C-H-I-R-A.
S-C-H-I-R-A. Yeah, you just look that up.
Look for his articles in the Reading Eagle every Sunday and
In the life section.
Wednesday.
Okay, no, well, let's just do this.
Sunday and Thursday. And he will be back here again once he gets his act together again. Here's one of his videos.
I couldn't get the one that I wanted to show, but this is another one. This one is called Rain Dance, and I made this one. I was in my car, and I was picking my daughter up, and she was in a pavilion about, I don't know, maybe 50 yards away, and it was pouring like crazy, but these boys that were playing basketball wasn't letting it bother them at all, and I... put the camera on my steering wheel and recorded them through my windshield, and then I edited it at home so that it would show them dancing. Now there's a classical piece I think it's by Mozart in the background, and
really cool.
Yeah, so
the rain almost abstracts it to this kind of wavy obliteration, and you're dissolving stuff in and out with different backboards and guys shooting. It's really, really ephemeral. It's nice.
Yeah,
and I'm ambient.
Well, this is 4 minutes long, but we're gonna we only have 1 minute left.
Yep.
So.
Well. All right, so is there anything else you want to tell your loving audience who watches you every month?
Give them some insight.
Yeah, give me some insight. Talk
no,
to me.
No, yeah. You give them some insight.
Oh, I give them some insight? Yes. Okay, I'll do that. Oh, you know what? I do have something else.
Oh.
This thing here.
Yeah.
Yeah. For a while I was making sculpture, and this is made of PVC pipe and and spray enamel. What I did, it's actually like this. It actually hangs like this. And, like that. And I made about 20 of these and had to show them over at Robert Pepper's in Reading Industrial Art. But I ran out of inspiration for it, because after I made so many of them, that was it.
Okay.
Know?
Well, we have to wrap this up. I'd like to thank you, everyone, for joining us. This was Ron Schira, the art critic of the Reading Eagle, the host for New Arts Alive and NAP Connections from Kutztown with James Carroll. And I was your host tonight, sitting in for Ron. My name is Peter John Snyder, and we hope to see you again sometime soon. Thank you and good night. Good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.